YOLO. All right.
That is the opening line.
What's up, guys?
The cast of Capitalist and Charlie Yang. What a legendary cast it's going to be. We have Volter Gaming facing up against FDL.
Exciting match, boys.
How amped are you to watch another Volter Gaming match, Charlie?
Reserve time. I cannot hide my excitement, Dota Capitalist. I am super excited to see the legend DDX, the Invoker Scriptor God from Argentina.
Come on, dude, that's my boy. That's my boy, come on.
Okay, fine. It was only a rumor.
It's only a rumor, come on. He just so happens to not play Invoker anymore since that rumor came out.
No, I actually have no idea. He could still be playing Invoker. Radiant team
pick. Well, they do go for the first pick IO.
Okay. And FDL are going to go for the... Oh, wait. Oracle's banned. They have that weird-ass obsession with Oracle.
I mean, the teams that aren't Cole, DC, and EG have this weird obsession with first-toing Oracle or something. Like, they think that hero's good.
Yeah.
Weird times.
So, that's a little bit more respectable. Phoenix.
Phoenix Void.
It's a 1-2 punch. Man, every single time I see Phoenix picked up, especially first pick Phoenix, I just get a little sad.
Why?
Because that's what ended our last qualifier.
5 seconds remaining.
We first picked Phoenix, and then we still got a 4 position that roamed.
Faceless Void.
And then we have an ass lane to deal with him off lane.
Yeah, I mean, you blame Blitz for that, those ass drafts. No wonder Liquid didn't win the Manila Major. Oh,
look, what a surprise!
We got Phoenix Void, guys!
Wow!
Who knew Volteur Gaming first banning that Oracle actually made FDL better?
5 seconds remaining. Oh, man.
Alright, let's see what Volteur's got here with that IO pick. Who are they gonna...
I bet they're gonna do some dumb... Bet they're gonna do some dumb.
I would tell you something about what I think this team is gonna do, but I actually know nothing about this team except that DDX is screwed.
Those of you who don't know, DDX is a rather good Argentinian player.
Yes, he is from Argentina.
These guys are mostly Argentinian.
Yes,
right?
That's what.
So yeah, he's rather good. Argentinian player. There's a rumor that he's a scripter, but either way, it still doesn't change the fact that he's quite individually talented. I played with him on a team. He was playing with 150 ping, 200 ping constantly, and it didn't matter.
Group gaming. Yeah. He has played with the legendary Blitz Dota, I believe, as well.
Yeah.
And they pick up the Beastmaster, very stable. Very good hero.
Currently, Volteur Gaming are still in the running for the playoffs of the round robin. It's because they've only lost 3 of their matches. They are right now
3.
Neck and neck with Drinking Boys, who have lost all 4 of their matches.
Hey, Drinking Boys almost took that game off Cole.
I know, it was like, ooh, Complexity. Complexity and Lion share more than just rafting style, apparently. We also seem to choke.
Oh, come on. There's lots of teams that have that in common.
Yeah, but in this qualifier, and they're expected to be top 3, then
they're
now struggling.
I mean, they haven't looked the greatest. Maybe their disappointing run at Manila sort of dampened some spirits, lowered morale, made them doubt themselves. Doubted themselves enough for FDL to
take the game.
Yeah, take that game off of them, man.
Do you think FDL's a better team over Complexity?
No, I don't.
I don't think so either.
I don't. I think there were tons of, I wouldn't say uncharacteristic mistakes out of Cole, but it was just, they played
a
lot worse than they normally do.
reserve yeah. time.
This will be the very first game of Radiant FDL since they got into the regionals, where they will not have Oracle. So we'll see how much better they are.
Stan King does like that hero a lot. He plays a pretty decent Oracle, but I think it's like...
10 seconds.
There are so many other heroes. Like, I watched the games where he did well on that hero. There are also so many other heroes that could have done the same thing, mm-hmm. or maybe something a little better. Like, you got a snipe off on a courier, but, you know, you could do that with some...
With Phoenix. Lion, not terribly surprising. It's just Dire about to say that hero. If it's not Disruptor with Phoenix, it's gotta be Lion with Phoenix. Just because you want a heavy disabler and you're facing a Wisp, etc., etc. So disables and burst damage, pretty favorable here. Vulture Gaming, just kinda ignore that Wisp for now and let the strategy play itself out. Looks like it could be a bit of a push strategy.
They got
fact,
the auras,
very
with
heavily
push
strategy.
Beastmaster, and then Venge also serves a dual purpose in being able to swap out somebody that gets chronoed.
Yeah, do you think this is a Drove strat? Where they have Venge, Drove, top, they
yeah,
have
very,
something with
possible. Very possible.
Because that would help you also bully out what is now, like, also kind of expected, the Timbersaw fourth pick for FDL.
If they do go Drow, it's not a lot of magic damage, though, to get through a Timbersaw, but
yeah.
if you have enough damage with the Venge Aura, the Drow Aura...
Yeah, and you push early enough where Timbersaw doesn't have...
5 seconds.
He still doesn't have starting armor, where he just has the Bloodstone and he has reactive armor, obviously, but he doesn't have, you know, 15 armor to start with because he has a plate mail. Then you can, your physical damage can still be effective. They will have problems with gap closers, Faceless Void, Timbersaw, both very mobile, Lion potentially mobile if he gets his Blink Dagger up early enough.
Ursa Warrior!
Ursa Warrior,
instead
okay.
they go for the Ursa. This... Team back. They go for Ursa and Dire, and they do have a really good Roshan lineup, but... I don't know, how do you feel about the Ursa matchup against... Timbersaw.
No, I think it's good against all these heroes.
Yeah.
I think it's
like whatever against Void. It's obviously good against Phoenix.
I can tell you playing this Ursa is really annoying because it's just like playing a Morphling. He's going to get all the last hits on you, and he's got this sustained damage that always makes you a little bit. Like, you can't actually go
Well,
forward.
We also don't know if it's that's an offline Void either.
Yeah, that's true.
Beast have played Carry Void. Maybe against Cole.
I can't believe that worked.
I think Cole let it work.
Yeah.
Not that it actually worked.
But yeah, I think Ursa's effective versus all these heroes. Burst damage against Void, Timbersaw, fast attack speed versus Phoenix. I really like this, actually. I think Volter are drafting rather well. I was a little bit nervous about the whole first pick Wisp. I think that, like, unless you're a team that is well renowned for their Wisp play, I'm automatically going to be a little bit fearful of Wisp first, just because I don't think that hero does enough for you.
Well, maybe Volter makes a name for themselves here at the Wisp
by beating legendary team Friendship Dedication.
By beating Bisa playing the carry.
Dire team back.
I mean, you scoff at this team, but. All these guys have actually been around for a while in North America. They're known within the scene. The CCNC is a young, pretty gifted Pubstar. Pubstar
got the right attitude.
Qualifier team now, yeah. Mm-hmm. Fluff said he's a pretty con guy. A lot of people praise his individual skill. Stan King has grabbed a bunch of guys together that believe in his drafting and. Bisa, everybody.
Very talented player.
Yeah. No, for the most part, probably the best player in the UK. Franzi is Elfrenzy, from back in Dota 1, played with AUI 2000 a lot. He's been around for a very long time, pretty gifted himself. And then MJW, Mike Jai White, was once considered one of the best players out of North America.
funny how many, I don't know, just every iteration of North American Dota, you have players like that.
He had school, and then back when he was like up and coming, Dota wasn't as big as it is now, so it's not something that he could fully pursue.
Storm Spirit!
Ooh, whoa! Okay! He's dealing with a lion and a faceless void, but it beats Timbersaw in lane, I believe.
If
it loses to Timbersaw, then this is
here's the thing.
Not a good
I think Storm Spirit is just a really bad hero now.
Yeah, sure. I mean, you're picking it into Faceless Void and Lion. The only reason in my head that you pick it up is at the very least it has to be Timbersaw in lane.
I mean, they're probably thinking that this is like a comfort pick. They just want to try something out. Who knows? Like, I don't think it... I think it does okay against Timbersaw. But you can... The mana change to Remnant really, really hurts in your melee matchups now. Like...
Yeah.
It's okay. But your transition to mid-game is going to be rough just because the ulti change is so bad. Now you have to... FDL gets a last pick Terrorblade. That dude has like an 80% win rate disqualifier. As the void disconnects, we see a pause. Alright, let's do predictions, dude.
Let's see. So I have Bisa for highest physical damage.
Yeah, I think that's super easy.
That's pretty clear. Last player to be killed, I think Ursa.
Wait. Oh, so...
What is Faceless Void facing?
Is this last player to be... Okay, so the player
the
that...
The very last player to receive a death.
Okay.
So I think...
So not at the end of the... Is this at the end of the game?
It's not at the end of the game.
Okay.
No, no, no. This is like 10 minutes in, somebody has zero deaths. I think Faceless Void could be an option because his lane isn't that threatening.
Maybe Storm or Ursa.
I think Storm is likely to get ganked.
It depends on how the game... Right, I could see a scenario where Storm happens.
I just can't imagine. I think that first Chronosphere, if it's not a smoke rotation from the Lion, then it's the first Chronosphere that
so
catches
we got
the Storm.
Timbersaw, Ursa.
I think Timber, Ursa are probably the best ones.
I'll go with Timber.
I'll go with Ursa.
Total number of player deaths by 10 minutes.
I mean, you know, it's an Ursa draft, so you know this is a possibility. There's no way FDL don't get caught by this. Right.
Well, they are moving towards... They are moving towards Gorshon. Ursa is just hitting... Gorshon. Not half quite. Alright, they're fine.
Yeah, they're mega screwed. Alright. FDL are just like, oh, hey!
Oh, Bisa! Oh, he's got a 5 hero reflection. Oh, the Ravage comes out from the Lion.
Jesus. All right, Sunray. Oh,
Sunray,
very good
hero.
Ability as well. Very good ability. How are you not a Volter dead yet?
Are you serious?
Wow.
What?
They get caught inside the Roshan pit where they're already kind of low.
They get a 5 hero reflection.
5
like
hero reflection.
Like a 3 hero impale.
Did FDL just not focus one hero very well?
Seems like it. How did nobody died?
I mean, Wisp is a great hero, but you can't heal. Did someone heal himself?
Well, on the bright side, FDL does get both bounty runes.
And on the bright side of Volter, they haven't lost the game yet. Because they attempted to level 1 Roshan with Ursa.
And they failed. That's
fairly obvious.
And they got 5 hero reflections.
And now Toon God has Iron Talon, but unfortunately no...
No boar.
Tangos to start with, and no boar. So I have no idea how you actually get level 2, but...
I mean, you just go and you Iron Talon and then you hit the camp. That's all you really can do, right?
Yeah.
Man, we could have been so wrong in our predictions there.
Oh, man. I bet the Aegis counts towards, like, not having a death, too. So if Ursa had like actually gotten the Roshan that picks up the Aegis, like he's most definitely the hero that dies last.
Oh, CC.
Yeah.
All right, I lost.
It goes
I picked
down.
The Timber Saw.
Oh, you already did lose, huh?
All right, my boy Ursa Algodon. Never heard of you before this qualifier, but you're my boy now. Other than that, with Storm Spirit, I guess this is the way that the Storm Spirit definitely beats Timber Saw.
Yeah.
He's got all this extra regen. I think without it, it's probably a fairly even matchup.
Probably, just because Timber Saw can just gain back HP from, from just taking creeps.
And Storm's gonna take some Whirling Death damage every once in a while. Yeah, this is the annoying thing. Fury Swipes, I think they buffed it in like the last patch or something, where it used to be 15 seconds, now it's 20 seconds. It's either last patch or the patch before that, where they buffed it up even more. I remember thinking like, oh god, that means my Faces Void versus Ursa matchups are like even more difficult, because he just swipes you, like, he hits you twice, and then for 20 goddamn seconds you have to stay away from him. Otherwise, he hits you again, he resets the counter, and then it's another 20 seconds.
It's got the Blightstone Orb of Venom combo.
You want the Ursa?
Yeah.
Man, if only Stan King over here had used that haste rune to invade the jungle, we could have found Jungad, who is very low jungle, but he's making his way through now. He's recovered since his level 1 attack speed aura, Inner Beast.
Yeah, the Wisp saving Voltura's lanes here after that disastrous start.
Yeah.
Not as disastrous as it could have been.
Saved them in the Roshan fight, got First Blood for TDX, is saving Jungad's jungle. Mm-hmm. He's doing everything right.
Beast has just got a free lane though, he's already pressuring the tower. It looks like the Beastmaster has just completely abandoned the offlane despite putting a lane, or not a lane, but
this is the right play. I hate it when I watch carries who have a free lane and they just don't pressure
the tower. Yeah.
Yeah. That's one thing that I think, I routinely notice this. Matumba ban on, like, the least likely hero to push towers early, on Slark, he's always harassing the tower early because he has a free lane and he knows, like, it's better to start chipping away at it now while you can.
And then you force maybe the rotation from the support or the offlaner to come back and zap it. I mean, that's what Dota's about now, it's just making the enemy team do things that they don't want to do, making suboptimal plays.
Lion up here at the top lane trying to protect MJW. He's having a pretty good time, it seems. He's level 4, he's got 16 CS. Now he's going to find Visco. Obviously, they don't really have the lockdowns to really kill him, so unless he makes a pretty big blunder, he should always survive it.
He's actually almost even. MJW is almost even CS with Ursa.
That's pretty bad.
That is very bad.
Volter trying to make that rotation to stop the push with Beastmaster. FDL, we're in position to try and actually gank that Beastmaster. At the very least, even if the gank wasn't successful, they are still keeping him mostly out of experience range and out of pull range. As you can see, the creeps stay on the tower, and Lisa is able to take the last one.
Right now, I think you're really seeing the skill difference in this offlane right now. It's like, MJW is basically keeping even with Ursa in that bench. Doesn't have the Void. To be fair, Venge is not the greatest support in the offlane Void.
Yeah, I mean, you just don't. I think that's actually the play. You don't zone him out, you just pull as much as possible.
You have to work in conjunction with your safe lane carry to zone him out. It's hard, but the Void shouldn't be getting this much farm. There's no way he should be.
Forcing out the time walk.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you have to do here.
Yeah.
The Ursa's not going to get as he's not going to get hitting the Void, but it's better than, I mean, the Void.
Yeah, and now it's too late because he's level 5, so you force him to time walk. He's not actually punished that much by it because it's a 12-second cooldown as opposed to the 24-second cooldown it was at level 1. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. They needed to pressure him earlier, force out the time walks, make him waste time. That didn't happen. He's got enough experience that he can't be punished any longer. And a successful gank from FTL onto DDX. Sure enough, the smoke gank came in on Phoenix. Very powerful ganking duo. Made it so even the Wisp can stop that damage. This is why like Storm Spirits. Like you hit level 5, you always go jungle. It's not even a question.
It's not worth it.
The enemy team
always. You want to take the risk of getting kicked and then delaying your level 6 even more.
Yeah. Especially with Wisp on your team, you know you've got stacks to work off of. So it's a bit of a strategic blunder there from DDX trying to make that the laning phase work for him instead of just defaulting to the safe option. Bisa, meanwhile, he's going to have a Dragon Lance very early on, and he can't really be challenged. The Storm Spirit is certainly not doing well enough in mid lane to put pressure on bottom. They need the Beastmaster to have his level 6 bare minimum. Even then, I think it's a pretty risky play to try and gank the Terrorblade just as easy as you can.
The thing that makes Storm even worse in this meta is that everyone picks pretty tanky, hard to kill cores now.
Yeah.
And like when Storm excelled is when people were picking things like Block. Not the Alright, production. Get out of here. Yeah, and so it's so much harder for Storm to get pickoffs in this meta.
Yeah. Just because you're so reliant on being able to burst a hero down. Certainly not cores. Volterra finally going to be able to go for Roshan, but it's likely to be contested.
Yeah.
And
TB Illusion's making their way over right now.
If you can't actually get Roshan with an Ursa team, then you've already got some really big issues. It's going to slow down the tempo of your game. There's some points to pick up Ursa outside of Roshan, but it's definitely one of the major points.
So what Voltour need to really do here is Beastmaster's hit 6 now. Just try and get a smoke gank off on I would say your ideal target is the Terrorblade. Because he's getting obviously Dyer's most net worth, and he's just pretty much getting uncontested farm pushing your bottom lane right now. But they need to be able to do something.
I feel like that smoke that they did never should have been for going through it.
Yeah, they did not have the control over the game to be able to go for that.
Yeah, they needed to pick first, and even if it would have been somewhat obvious with the way that MJW is playing very far forward in the top lane, he would have told you, hey, the Ursa's missing, etc. They should have at least tried to go for the smoke.
Yeah, at least you make FDL respond to you.
Yeah.
Rather than, like right now, FDL is free to sort of do whatever they want because the Storm and the Ursa are so busy trying to get up their own items. They finally do make another smoke rotation. It's with the Venge and the Beastmaster, and it looks like they are going towards that safe lane.
Got the right idea. We'll see if it works out, though, because Lion is sitting real close to Bisa.
When they ping it out, they know he's farming this camp.
They can wrap on through. Smoke is going to pop. Stan King is the one to pop it, and doesn't look like they're going to be able to catch Bisa in time.
Yeah, they waited too long to try and do something, and by that time, almost any experienced carry player is going to know, alright, something's up right now. They're not showing on the map. Ursa Whisper just sort of farming the lane pretty aggressively.
Bisa very routinely abandons his lane by 10 minutes.
He's a very experienced player. carry.
Gotta keep the knees going. And just like that, they lost their tier 1 tower, and we're not even gonna see a guaranteed Roshan falling into Mercer Gaming's hand in exchange once again. Interrupted halfway through. He's going to clear through the Roshan, pick up the Aegis, but now the question is whether or not FDL are going to be able to capitalize on just their positioning. They actually missed the Hex there, and as a result, Toon God is actually not going to be able to make it out. He just gets run over by the Timbersaw, the rest of Ulter Gaming, not having anything to be able to help their ally out.
But hey, if you're Vulture Gaming there, you take that. You definitely take it. You got the Roshan kill, yeah. You got the Aegis. All you have to sacrifice was a Beastmaster that's already sort of far behind.
It could have been so much worse. Could have been so much worse.
That's the story of this game so far.
Top 3 net worth all in the favor of FDL. I would like to say that's purely because they've taken objectives, but it's also because they are going to be able to take that tier 2.
The bright side is that Storm is not that far behind.
Yeah.
The downside is that Storm is just an awful hero now.
Storm Spirit definitely needs to be ahead in order to be have even
that, yeah.
the same kind of like impact that he used to have.
If you look at it, he's level 9 now. He hasn't made any of the jumps that we've typically seen out of Storm Spirits in the past. Mm-hmm. And it's because he feels like he can't kill anyone on FDL.
Yep. And he's probably right about that. He has if he was able to pick up Orchid by like 14-15 minutes, he could start threatening maybe like the Faceless Voids or Terrorblade, but
the Phoenix.
This is now going to be their third smoke gank that could fail. DDX doesn't have a disable, so he's not going to slow him down.
He jumps. I wouldn't even consider that like too long of a distance. He's like at less than half mana.
Yeah.
If he remnanted, he's at, 200 mana left, and then he has enough mana for one more jump.
Yeah.
And then he didn't use his Soul Ring there, but you've spent like your entire mana pool to close maybe 1,000 distance and do like 400 damage.
Not impressive. Now FTL got to go for a smoke of their own. Vulture Gaming are totally out of smokes, so if they're already losing a lot of map control. Unless they somehow clear through the aggressive vision that FTL is putting up, there's going to be no more offensive plays for Vulture. They're going to be completely red.
I do like that they did place offensive wards.
But unfortunately, it doesn't give them the information that FDL, 3-man smoked, head top. Get the Beastmaster, now gonna take a tier 2.
Yeah, I mean, I understand the idea behind those wards. They're gonna smoke up and smoke to those wards to fight around the vision that they had in the FDL's jungle, but.
And now Molter are struggling to trade a tier 1 for a tier 2, and they're the ones who have the Aegis, and yet they're also the ones that are going to be running away from FDL, knowing that they're too far behind to really fight. Molter, I'll get on Texan. He's going to lose his Aegis unless, oh god, that relocate. If he ended up dying there as the Ursa, and then the relocate goes back, he would have died twice. That was so close.
What? Looks like Voltura will only sacrifice the hero of this.
You could say Wisp is like... I know Admiral Bulldog, he made some comment about this player. I'm not sure if it was just for memes or...
Was it because of the name?
I think it
was. Because.
Yeah. But he said he liked what he was doing. He liked the plays that he was in. Could have been just for the memes, but honestly, in this game at least, he does seem to be the one player that is... job.
Yeah, he's trying to salvage this game as much as he can, but unfortunately, I think it really comes down to the
Radiant's
fact that
tower is under
that level 1 Roshan attempt put everybody behind too much. Beastmaster had to skill Aura first, and FDL got both kind of lanes, so a bunch of heroes had to TP to lane.
Yeah, it's a bad start for everyone. Except for the Storm Spirit, who got first blood. They're gonna have Necronomicon soon. Big upgrade in damage. I mean, this is like Beastmaster is supposed to be one of the somewhat better heroes. I, against Timbersaw. He's got Lockdown. He's got this Mana Burn that early on can be really effective against Timbersaw. But again, just like many of the other items of these heroes, it's just going to be a bit too TDX. Jumps all the way to CC&C, but it just tickles him.
Yeah, and he's going to opt to go for the Orchid route rather than go for the Bloodstone. Usually when you go Orchid, in the past you've done it when you're pretty far ahead and you can actually get a couple pickoffs with the Silence. Orchid timing most storms just go for the Bloodstone. So it's a little strange to see him going for, still committing to the Orchid pickup, but I feel like he probably feels like if he doesn't have it, they're not going to get any kills.
Yeah, they're just going to lose fights. The Orchid is very effective against all of these teams, all these heroes. Lion and Phoenix, obviously, I mean, any supports are going to be pretty well affected by the Orchid, but even the cores like Timbersaw and
Void. At this point, he won't be able to kill the Timbersaw.
Oh, I don't think he'll be able to kill the Timbersaw, but it's still effective in fights, potentially.
Yeah, maybe if he has maybe one more hero.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I actually didn't notice what he was doing here, but there's no way he's killing Timbersaw. Okay.
All right.
Jump a little bit farther. All right, CC. He's just getting distance at this point. Eventually, that relocate's going to wear out, and he's good.
He's just giving up, yeah.
Okay. Now he turns around. We have Chronosphere, Sunray on top of both of them. They're going to lose Alcadon, who normally has that Aegis. Now, Disco is also going to get caught off. Looks like he tried to go for the swap, maybe save the Ursa, but in the end, he is just another body of a pyre.
We have Sunspirit playing around with the Timbersaw up top. I don't think either of these heroes can really kill each other.
I was about to say it really is play, because there's no real danger of harm to either one of these heroes, which is more to CC's benefit than Storm's. CC's just happy to push down the lane.
You have a bunch of illusions sieging your tower from 700 range away.
All the way down at the bottom of the stairs, changing the landscape of the fight where you actually have to go into the clutch point rather than vice versa.
Yeah, it's so demoralizing to see that. The Terrorblade's already sieging the Orchid. 250 damage.
Oh god, we don't even have the Orchid yet. So he can't even, like, go for the Phoenix in the back and, you know, try and get a hero kill that allows them to win a team fight, perhaps. As is, even if they try and engage, they're still going to be the Supernova that kind of guarantees when they get to the fight. Now they're going to jump in, try and grab Beza. They're going to try and pop him, actually controlling MJW and killing him instead. Beza managed to get off his ultimate. They're going to get a lot of damage on the Volter here. There's the Supernova. They're going to be able to turn around and pop it. That being said, Beza gets the opportunity to just right-click down the Ursa. Happy with the one kill, now trying to escape, but it looks like DDX is going to be able to run him down, and Volter in a very successful hold against FDL. Granted, they lost their melee racks before.
Yo, you
range
take
racks.
That!
You definitely take that, because they had already lost their range racks before that fight even started. So
yeah,
the fact
they saved the important barracks. They got every single core, almost every single hero on FDL. They actually managed to kill Beza. Yeah. He used his Sunder early, ran out of mana, wasn't able to do anything, and then it's just, I think you really see the burst of the Ursa coming in through there.
Yeah.
Just takes out the Void immediately. MJW isn't able to get off of Chronosphere. It was a great roar by the Beastmaster. Great priority selection by Voltor.
I mean, I was a little bit questionable of it just because Chronosphere wasn't up. It was still 20 seconds, and I was like, well, why didn't they just focus down Beza? But it kind of worked out just because they didn't put enough damage on Beza that his Sunder wasn't actually that effective.
Void still offered a lot through, like, offers a lot through Vlad, so.
Yeah.
And then, like, Storm, it feels bad jumping in when a Void is up and you can possibly get time dilated.
Well, but, they're looking not great.
Signs of life.
But there is definitely signs of life. There is a small little glimmer of hope where Volter Gaming have managed to get themselves some gold to work with, some progression in items. Now they have a jumping item on the Ursa. Rather important, they have the controlling item on DDX with that Orchid. So they actually have opportunities to get an even better initiation than they had last time. And they may just find it on DDX, or excuse me, on B-side, top lane, DDX. Waiting in the wings.
It was a bit of a mistake out of FDL, but this time they do have the Chrono. They got more.
Oh, they see him. They've caught Bisa. They're going to be able to lock him down with the Orchid, and that is a free kill on the carry. That being said, Faces Void is going to be able to come in, manage to get the Chrono Sphere. TDX runs into it. They do manage to pop the Wisp. Now the question of time lock, he gets that too, so that's going to be two kills. They do manage to keep the Storm Spirit alive, but one for two for the main carry of FDL. That's not
and
that bad.
And a Chrono used.
And a Chrono used. That is not bad whatsoever from Volter, especially since, even so, like, Volter are pushing out the bottom lane pretty aggressively, too. So they're getting some free space for him. Unfortunately, they are so obsessed with this Roshan that they're wasting a bit of time searching for it because it is a very, very late one.
You know what I like about these qualifiers, and even when you look at teams that don't have the, I guess, the pedigree as others, is that even if you look at Voltor and Drinking Boys, they are going to get better as the qualifiers go on, and you're seeing that.
I think we've already seen Drinking Boys definitely get better over time.
Yeah, in the beginning, like, those games were not pretty at all.
Another great pickoff. Bisa just making some very aggressive movements around the map that are getting him caught out by Voltor every single time.
That said, I do think this is still a very tough game for Voltor if FDL can just move up and
stop having Bisa get solo picked off. Yeah.
But,
it's like he's forgotten what playing around Storm Spirit is like.
But Voltor will use this opportunity to try and go for the Roshan, but it is slowed again.
Yeah, doesn't matter. No Chronosphere this time around. Okay, we could even see a Bloodstone quite soon for DDX, potentially, at this rate. Oh my god, he's actually got the Soul Booster. I thought that was maybe Point Booster coming in. I didn't click on the Courier. That is a completed Soul Booster. So he probably will have Bloodstone before the next attempt at High Ground by FDL, which is probably in 5 minutes' time after the Aegis runs out. So maybe if they get a really good pick. Toon God, they're going to be able to burst him down rather easily. Looks like the Wisp is unable to save him on time with the Relocate. Alcadon pushing himself forward here is going to go for the Phoenix right away, forcing out that Icarus dive. Now the long jump in from DDX, who controls up Stan King first, but unfortunately they get caught by the Chronosphere. Supernova's going to successfully explode. Stan King gets the three-man stun, and it all turns so wrong for Volter. Just as they thought they had a hold on this game, FDL, they shut it down, and now our Wisp and Ursa are going to be two looking at a couple trying to escape, but that's just not going to happen. Algodon is going to be caught in, and our Wisp no longer has that relocate. In fact, he's even going to be caught as well. Gets the Yule Scepter, holding him in place long enough for the rest of the team to follow through, and that is going to be a second lane of Rax as Volter, they were spending their gold, so they actually do not have the buybacks to be able to defend this one.
I mean, the great equalizer coming through the Chronosphere. If Voltor did look good in those last pickoffs and last fights, if FDL puts together all their spells, it's with the gold lead they had, it's super hard for Voltor to win this game.
Yeah. And now Voltor are just left with that one lane of Rax. Nothing really stopping FDL from going a High Ground again, except for just their cooldown. So
yeah.
Chronosphere, Supernova, Metamorphosis.
I think they don't want to overextend again. Yeah. Respect to their opponent. They've punished you a couple times already. Just, you know, play good Dota.
Play good Dota indeed. Jesus, Stan King has Aether Lens and a Blink Dagger. I haven't actually taken a look at too much of FDL's items outside of Bisa and CC.
Yeah, that's really the problem for Voltor. Even if they jump in, so much of their lockdown and teamfight control is single target focused. Mm-hmm. And there's so many ways for FDL to counter initiate. Like, you have to be able to burst down a Void before it gets up Chrono, or burst down a Phoenix or any one of these cores. And Lion can, with a Blink Dagger Aether Lens, can always just blink back and counter initiate on your heroes.
Yeah, it'll completely halt the single target burst that Voltor are looking for between the Storm Spirit and
then the
Ursa.
Moment a Chronosphere gets put out with follow up,
Just like this, Algodon, he tries to go for CC, now gonna be controlled up and actually just loses his life as the blink in for the Timbersaw. Now they're gonna be able to get the Faceless Void Chrono as well. Might save Franz's life. Now he's gonna die to the Orchid, but still, it doesn't matter. That's definitely gonna win the fight for them. They clean up the whisk, make sure there's no escape on these heroes with the relocate. They're gonna leave the cores for last. DDX, probably the one to be able to escape here as he does have enough mana, it seems, to make the long jump away, but it doesn't matter. The GG call will come first. Volter Gaming will end up losing this game at 26 minutes to FDL. Yeah.
FDL continues this group, looking pretty good after they beat Complexity. But, you know, we spend a lot of time bagging on Voltour and Drinking Boys, but they looked a lot better here. I hope they learn a lesson in these qualifiers and realize, hey, if you stay together, you can, and you learn together, there's an opportunity for you to grow and play better teams.
Yeah. Absolutely. All right, guys, we are going to be taking a break. Very short break, though, because they're just trying to push the games forward as fast as possible. Our next game is going to be Drinking Boys. We've talked a little bit about them already on this cast. They're going to be facing up against the second qualifier team of Void Boys. So that'll be Charlie and myself. Hope you guys will stick around and enjoy the cast.